One of the most frustrating things you can encounter as a pedestrian is a signal that doesn't give you enough time to cross the street, leaving you stranded in the middle of the intersection, seemingly forever. So it makes sense that pedestrians in North America tend to be opposed to multi-stage crossings. But leaving you stranded in the middle of the street is not an intrinsic characteristic of multi-stage crossings. What they actually do is to provide more flexibility in the signal timings. It just so happens that some traffic departments take advantage of that flexibility to simply reduce the duration of pedestrian phases without accommodating the walking speed of pedestrians. But it's also possible to use multi-stage crossings to improve the level of service for pedestrians. And that's what I'd like to show in this video. First of all, if you compare two intersections with identical green durations, the one with two-stage crossings will have lower pedestrian delay. If someone starts crossing at the beginning of the green, they'll make it across in one go in either case, since both scenarios have the same total phase duration. If someone arrives later in the green, they likely won't be able to enter the intersection with a single stage crossing, but with a two-stage crossing they could at least make it halfway across. Then, when the light turns green again, they're already halfway across the intersection. But that's a fairly simplistic example. For more interesting examples, we head to the Netherlands, where virtually every pedestrian crossing has multiple stages. Typically, each crossing has two signalized stages, but if there's a dedicated transit right-of-way, it will be a separate stage as well. The fundamental advantage of multi-stage crossings is that each crossing conflicts with fewer other traffic movements. This means that there can be more chances for it to get a walk signal. Take, for example, this intersection in Rotterdam with a lagging left turn phase on the perpendicular street. The first half of the crossing doesn't conflict with the left turns, so pedestrians can start crossing while the left turns are still going. If there were only a single stage crossing, pedestrians would need to wait until the left turns were completely finished before even starting to cross. This same principle can also be applied to reduce the delay to other traffic without delaying pedestrians. At a typical signal in the Netherlands, when you arrive and press the pedestrian button, it doesn't just request a green at the first crossing. It also requests a green at the second crossing such that you get a green wave across the intersection. The duration of each walk phase is then based on an estimate of how long it will take to walk to that crossing from wherever you press the button. The crossing closer to you will therefore start its flashing don't walk much earlier than the further one. In this case, there was no conflicting traffic around, so both stages got a green as soon as I pressed the button, and only their durations varied. But when there is conflicting traffic, the start of the green light for the second stage will also tend to be later than the first. There's no point of stopping other traffic until the pedestrian has reached that side of the intersection. But what if there are pedestrians in both directions during the same cycle? Well, in that case, the signals provide enough green time for pedestrians in both directions to cross the entire street in one go. This could simply mean holding both stages long enough for someone to cross the entire street in either direction. But it's also possible to stagger the pedestrian green waves to favor a particular direction of conflicting traffic. In this case, I increase the amount of green time for eastbound traffic at the expense of westbound traffic. This could be useful for times of day when there's more traffic in one direction than the other. Or, it could be handy due to the particular movements at the intersection. At this Diamond interchange in Delft, there are far more signal phases exiting the interchange than entering. So the pedestrian green waves are timed such that the walk time across the exit lanes is kept to a minimum. There's plenty of time available on the other crossing anyway, so pedestrians can still cross in one go. These sorts of efficiency improvements for vehicle traffic come back around to benefit pedestrians as well. Because the sooner vehicle traffic is served, the shorter the signal cycle can be. And shorter signal cycles mean that pedestrians have a shorter wait until the next walk signal. As you may have noticed, typical Dutch traffic signals are set up completely differently than North American ones. Each direction tends to have its own fully protected signal phase, and these phases are combined based on the individual road users present in real time. The two-stage crossings make this possible while keeping delays low for all users. Having to wait for pedestrians to cross the entire intersection before allowing cars to turn would produce long delays for everyone, which is probably why North American intersections tend to allow traffic to turn while pedestrians are still crossing. Single-stage crossings would also eliminate many of the phase combinations that Dutch signals have at their disposal to efficiently serve the particular combination of people at the intersection. Multi-stage crossings are also, in my opinion, the single main reason that transit signal priority is so much more effective in the Netherlands than it is in North America. No matter how strong your priority is, if an approaching transit vehicle was detected right after a signal started a 40-second pedestrian phase, there's nothing the signal can do to provide a green in time. In the Netherlands, since dedicated transit rights-of-way have their own pedestrian crossings, the signal can almost always get a green light within about 10 seconds of detecting an approaching transit vehicle, since that's how long it takes to clear pedestrians across a typical 7-meter transit right-of-way. The clearance time for any motor traffic movement will be way less than 10 seconds. And the length of other pedestrian crossings doesn't really matter since they don't conflict with the transit movement. And while it typically isn't possible to accurately predict the arrival of a transit vehicle 40 seconds in advance, you can get a pretty accurate estimate 10 seconds in advance, as long as there isn't a stop right before the intersection. In my hometown of Toronto, the way that the traffic signal operations policy describes multi-stage crossings is pretty consistent with how they're generally used in North America. It describes how multi-stage crossings can reduce the impact of pedestrian phases on other traffic, but doesn't describe how they could be used to reduce the impact of other traffic on pedestrians. Pedestrians are very important to the City of Toronto, so given how North American multi-stage crossings have historically been implemented in a pedestrian-unfriendly way, it makes sense that the city's policy is to use single-stage crossings as much as possible. But the Dutch experience shows us that multi-stage crossings don't have to be bad for pedestrians. If the city explored how multi-stage crossings could be used to introduce protected turning phases without increasing pedestrian delay, they might just adopt the opposite policy.